You want to understand how fatigue cracks like this one can be avoided? And how the service life of parts can be calculated for a given load spectrum by using the minus rule? Then this is definitely the right video for you here at the YouTube Engineering Academy. I'm Nico, I'm a German engineer, and today I will explain you the fatigue life assessment by using the minus rule. When loaded parts and roller bearings are operated over a long time at a certain load level, they often break down due to fatigue damage. Typical fatigue damage patterns are shown in these pictures. At roller bearings, here shown on the left side, small pinholes occur on the surface of the race, the so-called pittings. Subsequently, small grains break out so that the bearing can no longer be operated anymore. At the torsionally stressed beam on the right side, we can see a typical fatigue crack. The crack initiated at the top, from where it grew inwards along the lines of rest until a forced fracture destroyed the rest of the cross-sectional area. In general, the fatigue life of the parts depend on the occurring load and the number of total load cycles. For loaded parts that are stressed during operation, there exists a material-dependent stress number curve that gives us an indication about the expectable fatigue lifetime. This SN curve, according to Wöhler, describes the number of load cycles N a component can withstand depending on the occurring stress level. If both axes are plotted logarithmically, there is a linear relationship between the stress amplitude sigma and the tolerable number of load cycles N. The higher the stress level, the lower the endurable fatigue lifetime is. If the stress amplitude remains below the endurance strength sigma ES, the material is fatigue resistant, which means that it can withstand the load forever without breaking. Sigma ES is therefore a threshold value for the SN curve, which divides the material behavior into two areas, the time resistant and the fatigue resistant. In the time resistant area, the SN curve descends linearly with a slope. In the fatigue strength range, it runs parallel to the n-axis. The bearing service life curve looks very similar. Here, too, we get a linear correlation between the existing bearing load F and the number of possible bearing revolutions N until a fatigue damage occurs when both axes are plotted logarithmically. The dynamic load rating C is defined to describe the dynamically variable bearing load and can be found in the roller bearing catalogs of the manufacturers. In contrast to the fatigue strength amplitude, the dynamic load rating C is not a threshold value, because the service life curve continues in the same way at a higher number of revolutions, shown here by a dashed line. The dynamic load rating C is a statistical value. It has been established to be able to describe the curve at a large number of revolutions. The slope of the curves depend on the material, the stress type, and the bearing type. Let us consider a part that is loaded by a stress sigma 1, which is significantly higher than sigma ES. The stress level sigma 1 shall be the load at which the service lifetime is 10,000 load cycles. These are represented here by 10 orange boxes. The first 1,000 load cycles cause 10% of the available lifetime damage to be used up. The next 1,000 load cycles add 10% of lifetime damage. With every further 1,000 load cycles at this stress level, another 10% of the available lifetime damage is used up until 100% damage sum has accumulated after 10,000 load cycles. The minor damage sum D1 is then the number of load cycles N1 divided by the number of possible load cycles L1 on that stress level. In this example, it's 10,000 divided by 10,000, which equals to a minor damage D1 of 100%. What we just saw is a linear damage accumulation. For roller bearings, this hypothesis has been developed by the Swedish engineer Arvid Palmgren and the American Milton Minor, and is therefore called the Palmgren Minor Rule. For several SN curves, you will just find it variously also called as Minor's Rule. It states that every load or stress level sigma I contributes a share of damage during operation, which means it consumes a part of the available total service life damage. This share can be calculated by setting the number of load cycles Ni in relation to the sole service life Li on this stress level. The sum of all single damages is then the total damage D of the loaded part. If the amount of damage reaches or exceeds the value of 1, the available lifetime damage has been used up. The damage level is then reached where a fatigue damage is probable. It is extremely rare that the technical systems are just running on a constant load level during operation. In general, the load changes during operation. That's why the question is of great interest of how the service life can be calculated when a load spectrum occurs. To do so, we look at an exemplary load spectrum, which is shown here. It shall consist of three load levels. The first stress level sigma 1, at which the service lifetime is 10,000 load cycles. This is run during 4,000 cycles. Then a lower stress level sigma 2 occurs, at which the sole lifetime is 50,000 load cycles. This is run during 15,000 cycles. The question then is, how many load cycles are possible on stress level sigma 3 lower than the fatigue endurable stress sigma ES? Theoretically, the lifetime on this load level would be endless. We will see that there exist different approaches to predict a more precise number of possible load cycles. Let us consider the damage accumulation on stress level sigma 1. As said before, the service life L1 is 10,000 load cycles. Then it's rather easy to understand that the 4,000 load cycles cause 40% of the available lifetime damage. That means that 60% of the possible service life damage remain for the upcoming load levels of the considered load spectrum. The minus sum D1 calculates N1 equals 4,000 load cycles divided by the possible lifetime L1 equals 10,000 load cycles. The result is 40%. Based on this previous damage, we now consider the additional damage accumulation on stress level sigma 2. The single service life only on this level is L2 equals 50,000 load cycles. We now run 15,000 load cycles represented here by 15 blue boxes at level sigma 2, what results in an additional minor damage sum of 30% as shown in this equation. Cumulative damage after the second load level is then 40% plus 30% equals 70%. So that 30% of the available service life damage remain. Now we'll have a look on how the remaining service life damage can be used up to 100%. The miners rule defines the maximum damage can achieve 1 before a fatigue failure will probably occur. So the minor damage D3 of the last load level is calculated by the number of loads N3 divided by the number of possible loads L3 and must be less or equal to 0.3. When we run the system on a stress level sigma 3 above the fatigue endurable stress sigma ES, we are in the time resistant area of the SN curve. If the lifetime L3 of sigma 3 would be, for example, 1 million load cycles, shown here by the 1,000 gray boxes, the still possible number of load cycles would then be N3 equals 0.3 times 1 million, which results in 300,000 additional load cycles. More interesting is the case when the occurring stress level sigma 3 is below the fatigue endurable stress level sigma ES. Then we are in the fatigue resistant area of the SN curve. The minor damage is still N3 divided by L3 and must be inferior to 0.3. Technically speaking, such a stress level can be withstand eternally, so that L3 becomes infinite and the possible number N3 also becomes infinite. This is shown here by an endless row of green boxes on stress level sigma 3. Practically, there are already initiated cracks in the part that will result in a later breakdown. To estimate a more precise number, there are two modifications of the miners rule. The first is the also called modified miners rule, shown here by the dark blue line. The slope of the fatigue life curve below the fatigue endurable stress level is set to 2 times k minus 1, so that we get a finite possible load cycle number L3m, and with the pre-damage from the first two load levels, a finite possible number n3 equals 0.3 times L3m. When you are not really sure if the curve slope is as shown as estimated by the modified minor approach, then you just can use the original slope k and calculate with the so-called minor elementary approach. With this, you will get a more conservative result for L3e with an even more reduced possible number n3 equals 0.3 times L3e. With this, we have reached the end of this lesson. Thank you very much and see you again at the YouTube Engineering Academy.